Out front next, breaking news. The accused shooter in the Texas high school rampage set to make his first court appearance this hour as police are searching for more bombs. The FBI right now using bomb techs at the shooting scene to try to find more. Plus, the suspect is a 17-year-old who played football. Students say he's also been showing up to school in a long trench coat. Pictures of his jacket with Nazi symbols actually pinned to it. And Trump and his allies say an FBI informant was planted in his campaign. U.S. officials say that's not true. Even Rudy Giuliani says Trump doesn't know. So why are they talking about it? Let's go out front. And good evening, I'm Erin Burnett. Out front tonight, the breaking news. The 17-year-old high school student charged with capital murder today for killing 10 people in a Texas high school is expected to appear in court any moment. It's this high school in Santa Fe, Texas, devastated today by yet another American school shooting. 9 students and 1 teacher dead tonight, at least another 10 injured. And tonight, a second person in custody, an 18-year-old, who, according to one law enforcement official, is believed to be a possible accomplice of the shooter. This comes as we are learning chilling new details about the shooter himself and his plot. According to officials, he is Demetrios Pagertis. Officials say he was armed with his father's shotgun and a revolver, started shooting just as classes were starting this morning. There was panic and chaos. Students were running for their lives with their hands in the air.
They heard 3 shots. I called my mom and I heard 4 more shots.
I heard so many people saying that, like, it was gunshots and that, like, people were dead.
I was scared for my life. Nobody should go through this. Nobody should be able to feel that in school.
And tonight, a discovery that reveals just how much carnage the alleged gunman wanted to inflict. A law enforcement official says pipe bombs and pressure cookers were found nearby the school and at the school. And they are looking for additional devices at this hour. They're right now using bomb techs, K-9s, to process the scene. That's what the FBI is telling us at this moment. Nearby, investigators searching a trailer. They believe the suspect assembled at least some of the bombs there, where you see on your screen. In just a moment, I'm going to speak to a student who was inside the school when the massacre began. He knows the alleged shooter. First, though, let's go to Nick Valencia. He is out front. He is live in Santa Fe. And Nick, obviously, we have a court appearance happening any moment this hour. We know K-9s are looking for more bombs. What more are investigators saying to you about the shooting tonight?
Erin, the depressing reality of what happened here earlier this morning in Santa Fe is now starting to set in the community. The federal authorities are also considering bringing their own charges against the 17-year-old, they say, to try to send a message and to keep this from happening again.
We're making entries. What else? Shots fired.
More shots fired. Additional shots fired.
Gunshots rang out at Santa Fe High School in southeastern Texas just after classes started this morning. The shooter walked into an art class around 7:30.
Still have several more shots fired.
Police shooting. He's in the art room. We got shots fired right now, guys.
9 students and 1 teacher killed. An additional 10 people were injured, including school resource officer John Barnes, who was shot in the elbow. Survivors describe a harrowing scene inside the school.
All the teachers are telling us to run, run, go, like, run. Me and my friend Ryan Calvert ran to the forest so we could get shelter. And that's when I called my mom.
It's like instinct. You're scared, you're traumatized, so you're running as fast as you can.
Parents received the unthinkable call. An active shooter inside their child's school.
If you would have heard what I heard this morning, the fear in my loved one's voice because of my son being in that classroom.
Really scary. Really, really scary.
17-year-old Demetrios Pagertis is in custody and is believed to be the shooter. The Texas governor said authorities are speaking to 2 other people in connection with the crime. On his Facebook page last month, the accused gunman posted a photo of a T-shirt with the words, "Born to Kill." In addition to the use of a shotgun and 38-caliber revolver during the shooting, explosives were found nearby that could have caused much more damage.
There have been explosive devices found in the high school and surrounding areas adjacent to the high school. Because of the threat of these explosive items, community members should be on the lookout for any suspicious items.
Law enforcement says the explosive devices included homemade pipe and pressure cooker bombs, as well as a Molotov cocktail. Sources tell CNN that investigators have searched a nearby trailer where it is believed the explosives were assembled. The students of Santa Fe High School now have to grapple with being the latest school on a growing list affected by a mass shooting.
Nobody should have to go through this, and nobody should feel that pain. It hurts my heart to see this.
I'm about a mile away from where that shooting happened this morning at a local gymnasium where family members and parents are coming to try to make contact with loved ones that they still have been unable to reach. It was just a short time ago, Aaron, that I spoke to a young woman who says that her aunt is a permanent substitute at Santa Fe High. She still hasn't been able to reach her since this morning. And real quick, it is worth noting that this high school, shortly after the Parkland shooting happened on Valentine's Day, went through their own scare where they were put on lockdown after a school threat. That nothing happened then, but today it was the real thing. Aaron.
All right, thank you very much. And you know, you may have seen on your screen, this is the 22nd school shooting of the year in the United States of America. Texas Senator Ted Cruz spoke today. He was angry after another mass shooting in his state.
Texas has seen the face of evil. What happened this morning here in Santa Fe defies words. The agony, the hell that parents, that this community is going through is unimaginable. There have been too damn many of these.
He's right about that. And too little has been done to stop them. And they are hurting students. Listen to this young woman, a survivor whose life was changed forever this morning.
It's been happening everywhere. I've always kind of felt like eventually it was going to happen here too. So I don't know. I wasn't surprised. I was just scared.
Out front now, Aiden Gomez. He's a student at Santa Fe High School. His mother gave us permission for him to be on with us tonight, and he knew the suspected gunman was on the school's football team with him. So, Aiden, look, thank you so much for doing this. Unimaginable to imagine what you are feeling and going through tonight. What happened, Aiden?
Around first period, we were in first period for about 30 minutes, and a fire alarm went off. When the fire alarm went off, we started evacuating, and my classroom was right by the special needs classroom, so they were evacuating at the same time we were. And usually during drills, they evacuated about 15 minutes before us, so I knew something had to be wrong, that they weren't evacuated before us. So as they were evacuating, I held the door open for them, and we stood on the sidewalk as we would for a regular drill. When a teacher came running across the school, yelling at us, telling us to run. So we ran to the highway 6, and that's when she stood on the highway, stopping traffic, telling us to get across the highway. So we went behind this building, Indian Automotive, and we took cover behind there for about an hour, as they took a head count of everyone. And after they got everyone counted for, we loaded buses up and we all came here to the Alamo where we reunited with our families.
And Aiden, you know, I know that you knew the suspected, the gunman. What do you know about what he did today? What can you tell us?
I know that he was wearing the same trench coat that he wore all the time, and I've heard a lot that he was also wearing the shirt that he posted on his Facebook.
Which one? Was that the one that we've been looking at, the Born to Kill?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
And I know you knew him, and you'd been, that we're looking at the T-shirt now that he had posted on his social media, on his Facebook. What were your interactions like with him?
He was kind of a quiet kid. Every time you try to start a conversation with him, he just kind of like laugh. He wouldn't really continue on with the conversation. He didn't really like interacting with other students.
Was he, Aiden, an outcast? Was he picked on? Do you know anything about, I mean, what can you tell us about sort of his role socially in the school?
He wasn't really picked on. He was kind of an outcast of kind of how he dressed. Everybody like looked at him different because he wore the trench coat with the badges on there. And I don't believe that he was picked on, though.
No, but he wore that trench coat, it sounds like you're saying, all the time.
Yeah.
When you heard that it was him, what was your first reaction, Aiden?
I was kind of surprised. I didn't think he would do something like that. He doesn't seem like that kind of kid.
And obviously, nine of your fellow students were killed today. A teacher was killed. There are others in the hospital tonight. Do you know any of the victims?
Yes, ma'am.
What can you tell us about them?
They were nice students. I'm sure their families loved them a lot. And it's school's going to be different without them.
Bladen, thank you. I know it's going to be hard as you're just even trying to process this. Thank you so very much for being willing to speak with me.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Bladen Gomez, as you heard there, a student, someone who knew the alleged shooter. You heard what he had to say. I want to go now to Art Roderick, former U.S. Marshal, and Juliette Kayyem, former Assistant Secretary for the Department of Homeland Security. And Art, you heard Aiden say he was sort of an outcast, but by choice, not picked on, that he always wore that trench coat. He was saying that he even thought that he was wearing that Born to Kill shirt today. What do you take away from that?
Well, I think where the investigation's going now, I mean, we look at his Facebook page. There's not a lot of information on there, okay. But obviously he's wearing a trench coat, kind of a dark look. I don't know if he had the swastikas on there or the Iron Cross on there, but I think what they're doing right now is they're out rolling a lot of law enforcement people out there, not just the police department, but also FBI, ATF, U.S. Marshals, DEA, anybody that's on these task forces right now to assist. And what I've been hearing, Aaron, is that they're rounding up anybody that could have had any contact with them, either recently or in the past. So they're picking up a lot of people and talking to them. And also, you know, the students on the ground there also provide a bunch of intel. So there's a lot going on right now, a lot of information flowing in. Yeah. And they will nail this down fairly quickly as to who else could have assisted him with this particular
crime. And on that point, Art, are you hearing anything? I know, you know, you heard our reporting, an 18-year-old that one law enforcement official tells us is believed to be a possible accomplice is now in custody. Do they feel that they have anyone who could have actively helped, or what else are you hearing?
I'm hearing they're looking for other people out there, at least one or two more specific people that either went to that high school in the recent past or currently are in that high school. So they're casting a wide net here, as they should, to gather as much information as they can, because it just appears to me somebody else knows something out there, or somebody else could very well have assisted him.
And Juliette, you know, we also now know, right, about these pipe bombs, right, that there were there have K-9 teams now looking for more, right, that he was assembling them in a trailer, that there were some outside the school. They're looking now inside the school. They're have these FBI, says K-9 teams. What does that say to you? Bombs and many of them.
So it says two important things about today, and why I do think today is different, not only because the assailant does not have this kind of record that we've gotten used to in terms of interactions with law enforcement.
All right, I'm sorry, Julie, I just want to interrupt you briefly as you finish your point. Right now, everybody, you're looking behind that door line is the suspect. The 17-year-old alleged shooter, his first court appearance, you can see there. Making sure there isn't anything to hear here for everybody. It doesn't appear there is, but this is the first court appearance that you're looking at. We're going to keep monitoring this as this comes in Galveston, Texas, where the alleged shooter is now appearing in court. Obviously, he's been charged with capital murder. And Juliette, you're talking about why what he did is different.
So because he doesn't have this background. So the first factor is, of course, the IEDs, the explosives. That makes me think, like, as we heard from law enforcement statements today, and as Art is confirming, that there may have been other people involved. That's very hard to plan on your own. You're a 17-year-old boy. How are you purchasing the stuff? Where are you testing it? It's expensive. You know, I mean, those kinds of things are factoring into a belief that there might have been others helping him. So in some ways, this is a lot like Columbine. Which also involved two people.
Right. Or also they appear to be talking right now, so we're going to listen in. I'm sorry to interrupt again. Let's listen.
And you have been charged with aggravated assault against a public servant. I'm denying your bond on both charges. You have the right to retain counsel. You have the right to remain silent. You have the right to have an attorney present during interviews with peace officers or attorneys representing the state. You have the right to terminate that interview at any time. You have the right to request appointment of counsel if you're indigent and cannot afford it. You have the right to an examining trial. You are not required to make a statement. Any statement made by you may be used against you. Are you a citizen of the United States? Are you a citizen of the United States?
Yes, sir.
Are you requesting consideration for a court-appointed attorney?
Yes, sir.
Are you out on bond for any other charge?
No, sir.
I'm going to ask you to sign the front page, which is just acknowledging that I read you your rights this afternoon. You're not entering a plea today. Thanks. I'm going to have you sign a second time requesting consideration to be appointed a court-appointed attorney, and a third time saying that you'll keep your appointments and tell us if you change your address or phone number. One more time right here, please, saying that you're requesting that court-appointed attorney.
Application now or
then?
Judge.
I'm sorry?
To the next window.
To the next
window. Oh, to the next window. Do I need to do it over again? Do I need to do it over again?
Okay.
All right, any questions? All right, we are finished. They're going to work on the application a little bit later.
Okay.
All right. Come on.
And now they're leading him away as we watch that, taking the court-appointed attorney. What's your reaction to that, Juliet? Obviously, he was there with his handcuffs on.
So justice sort of plays itself out here. I mean, in other words, he's going to face capital crimes. This is going to be a state case. I don't see any reason why there would also be federal charges at this stage, unless we learn something about motivation, which would make it a federal crime. But I think that this will be a state case. Depending on if he's talking or not, we understood that he was talking earlier, find out more about motivation. I think that's clear here, both motivation and then, of course, is there a conspiracy or are there others? You need to make sure this community continues to be safe. There are explosives around that we can't seem to account for right now. It's just ensuring that this day is over. Art?
Yeah, I mean, that just seemed to me to be like a standard initial appearance. His rights were read to him. He answered a couple questions. They established identity. That's part of all the initial appearance. And he was denied bail based on not only the homicides, but also the assault on the two resource officers, which are public officials. So this is what we see in any crime like this. I think from this point on, we just move on from here. And hopefully, law enforcement was able to get some information on the initial debrief they had with him.
Right. And of course, Juliet, they're in a race right now because they don't know how many of these explosive devices there are. They don't know where they are. They don't know if anyone else was involved. Right. So as you point out, still concerned about whether there could be any more risk. But what do you say about the fact that there were so many? And obviously none of them went off. Right, whether he was intending them to later. I mean, it's unclear at this point whether that was 100% a failure or not. But they didn't explode while he was putting them together. In other words, it would seem there had been a lot of practice or precursor work.
Absolutely. You can't just put these together in a day. There's training, there's purchase of materials. So, you know, to the extent that he seems to have come out of nowhere, no one seems to have any hint that this was about to happen. There were activities that so in other words, that's what led to Al-Qaeda using four airplanes. In the school shooting instance, you're not seeing now just school shootings. You've now seen at least one person now try to ratchet up to say, I'm not just a school shooter, I'm something bigger, whatever it is that motivated him. So that's disconcerting. Yeah.
Extremely disconcerting. Thank you both. And next, our breaking news coverage continues. We're just learning that neighbors of the suspected shooter reported hearing an explosion this morning. Obviously, it could be incredibly significant here as we assemble the timeline and the intent and the motive. Details on that and students injured in the mass shooting. Some of them tonight still fighting for their lives.
We have the latest on their condition. We'll go to the hospital tonight. And President Trump accusing the feds of planning a spy explosion happened around 5:40 a.m. this morning. Now, that's incredibly significant because we know, of course, that there were multiple pipe bombs near and at that school. And this 5:40 a.m. would have been just a couple of hours before the attack at the high school in which the shooter allegedly killed 10 people, 9 students and a teacher. Just moments ago, the 17-year-old made his first court appearance. We saw that there, eerily quiet and calm, in contrast to the carnage and chaos that he caused this morning. Police say he was armed with a shotgun and a revolver. We understand both of those belonged to his father. Investigators are looking into explosive devices, as I said, found in the school and also in a vehicle believed to have been assembled in the trailer you see there. Right now, there are FBI teams, K-9 teams, trying to find more explosives. They're talking to others, possibly, that could have been involved or known something. The question is, could anyone have known what happened, and why did he do this? Who is he? Alex Marquardt is out front.
Tonight, the shooter in custody, wearing a jail's orange jumpsuit. In some photos posted online, Demetrius Pagorchis looks like a typical teenager with peace and love symbols on a black baseball cap. His alleged actions on Friday were anything but, and his social media profiles are now offering clues to a dark side. Less than 3 weeks ago on Facebook, Pagorchis posted this chilling picture, a t-shirt with the words, "Born to Kill." The same day, he posted another image of a long black coat. Pinned on it, among other symbols, was a Nazi iron cross, which he said stood for bravery. On the collar, a communist hammer and sickle, representing, he claimed, rebellion. Possibly the coat he was known to often wear.
He doesn't really talk to very many people either. He keeps to himself. He wears a trench coat every day, and it's like 90 degrees out here.
And on Pagorchis's Instagram account, the tools of death. A pistol and a serrated knife lying on a bed, the caption reading, "Hi," followed by an expletive. In another post, an arcade game using a sniper rifle to take out targets. Today, authorities said a second young man, 18 years old, was also arrested as a possible accomplice. The shooter, they said, had 2 guns, and authorities found explosives in and near the school. The governor of Texas added that the guns used, a shotgun and a .38 revolver, were his father's and legally bought. Journals written by Pagorchis also showed that he planned to commit suicide after the attack.
The shooter has information contained in journals on his computer and cell phone that he said that not only did he want to commit the shooting, but he wanted to commit suicide after the shooting. As you probably know, he gave himself up and admitted at the time that he didn't have the courage to commit the suicide, that he wanted to take his own life earlier.
It was also on Facebook that Pagorchis confirmed that he went to Santa Fe High School. He claimed he would be joining the Marine Corps, writing that he'd start next year, though the Marines said they don't have a record of him. The 17-year-old junior had played on the JV football team. School reports indicate that he was a standout player, and at one point in sixth grade, a standout student as well, on the honor roll.
Aaron, the only red flag that the authorities say was around Pagorchis was that t-shirt which said "Born to Kill," and that warning sign was posted on April 30th, was clearly missed. Now, the governor of Texas said today that other than that, there was no reason to be worried about Pagorchis. There were no arrests. There was no criminal record. He had what Governor Abbott called a clean slate. Now, that Facebook page has been taken down today by the company. Aaron.
All right, Alex, thank you. And now criminologist and behavioral analyst Casey Jordan, along with former FBI assistant director for the Criminal Investigative Division, Chris Swecker. Chris, let me start with the breaking news here. ATF agents now say neighbors have said they heard an explosion at the shooter's home at about 5:40 a.m. this morning. Obviously, that was only about, 2 hours before this began. What does that say to you?
Yeah, Aaron, it raises questions about what he was doing. Obviously, there was quite a bit of pre-planning here. I mean, I'm hearing reports of a pressure cooker bomb. I'm hearing reports of other types of bombs. You can't learn how to do that in school at age 17. You learn that on the internet or in other sources. And we know it goes back several weeks. He has 2 of his parents' guns. You have to wonder how he got his hands on those guns and who was paying attention to what he was doing. This isn't Parkland. We had all these red flags and warnings pop up, but people that are close to the shooter are noticing things and should be picking up on things, particularly the parents in this case.
And on this point, Casey, we don't know much, but 5:40 a.m. obviously is a time neighbors would be home. Parents would ordinarily be home. We don't know what they did, what their hours were, but we do know that the guns that he had on him today were his father's.
Right.
But we don't yet know anything about what law enforcement have been able to learn from this family or from these parents.
Yeah, I am sort of impressed by how quickly we've gotten a lot of good information, but we still don't know anything about his family situation. A lot of the things that we look at are not just the personality, but the family situation, the social situation, the peers, and what they're doing, media, online, that sort of thing. The big missing link right now is the family. But you got to keep in mind, Columbine kids stayed up all night long building bombs in their basement, and their parents never even knew, and they were in the same house. I think that that bomb going off at 5:40 this morning is what triggered him to choose today to go and do the massacre at the school. He knew neighbors had to have heard it, and that means that somebody might come around.
So that actually could have been, as opposed to a practice of the intentional day, something happened to it because of the noise. He said, well, I'm going to do it today.
What if police come around wondering what that explosion was, looking for what's going on in this trailer? Oh my gosh, if they find out all this stuff, I'm going to get caught, so might as well just, you know, the jig is up, let's go. It doesn't seem like it was terribly well planned. The other big question is the accomplice. Why wasn't he part of the shooting? Did he help him build the bomb? So those two big questions, the accomplice and did the parents have any clue? Those are the things we really need to find out.
And Chris, we know nothing at all about this, you know, possible accomplice, right? We know an 18-year-old young man who is now also in custody. Right. And that could have been an accomplice. But we don't yet know what role this person played or, you know, why they weren't part of the actual shooting today.
Certainly, we don't know if they're witting or unwitting. We don't know whether this person shared this ideology, whatever it was. You know, he apparently was studying Nazism and he had some very, very dark sort of dark side to him. The trench coats. Perhaps he was looking back on Columbine. But as I said, there's always a sort of a social network around these people who really are in the best position to pick up on red flags. And it just didn't happen in this case.
Yeah, I
will say, though, sort of going off in another direction, it sure is very fortuitous that we had a school resource officer in place. And I think that's a best practice as I go around and do school security assessments.
Right. I mean, you'd rather have them than not have them, but, you know.
Right.
Yeah, I'm not trying to get into the full politics here, but I mean, you know, these things shouldn't be happening to begin with, and you still had 10 people who were killed today. Let me say, Casey, the governor of Texas, Greg Abbott, says there were either non-existent or imperceptible red flags. I just want to play what Governor Abbott said.
And here, the red flag warnings were either non-existent or are very imperceptible. There is, from his Facebook page, a T-shirt that says Born to Kill. That would be maybe the only, if not the foremost, warning sign.
Obviously, the governor wouldn't be speaking if he weren't confident about that. Is it possible that at this point they're really confident enough to say there were no warnings?
No, the foremost warning sign is access to firearms. And if his father had some in the house or he was able to get them, that's the number one thing that should be considered a red flag. Now, with social media, understand, kids are always, especially in the teenage years, tend to flirt with expression. They love their First Amendment rights. They love, you know, to look rebellious and angry and latch onto dark things. I have worked in high schools. There are kids with far darker pasts than this. But the point is that the warning signs we always find after the fact. The question is, who is watching for them as they go? Are the parents aware of what's happening, what he's doing in the middle of the night, what kind of websites he's on, what kind of music he listens to?
We don't have those answers yet. Chris, what we do have right now, you know, we had just seen the 17-year-old alleged shooter appear in court, right, the first court appearance, because as you heard the governor say, he planned to commit suicide and then didn't have the ability to do it. The Judge Henry just spoke a moment ago about what happened in that court, and I wanted to play it for you.
He apparently was cooperating with the police, answering questions, agreed to be interviewed, waived his rights to remain silent. So that's just what they've told me up until this point, and it's consistent with what I saw.
Chris, what does that say to you? He's saying he was cooperating.
Not surprising, someone that of that age, 17 years old, cooperating before the lawyer comes on the scene. And frankly, the officers are going to get as much out of them as they possibly can before he does get a lawyer. So I don't expect that to continue until, you know, it may be a strategy later after the lawyer, after he consults with the lawyer, but I expect him to clam up pretty soon.
And what else are they going to be looking for signs? Because, again, we don't know anything about the family. We don't know a whole lot yet fully about social media, at least that has come out, or what he was doing or what his relationships were like, or, in fact, even if there's only one person who may have been involved or if there are others.
Right. So I think that, you know, it's what they're going to find out, what they'll be interested in is, was there a specific event? How long has he been thinking about this? You know, the fact that he played football 2 years ago or was an honor student 5 years ago is really irrelevant. I'm interested in what's happened to him in the last few months. These things happen most often in the springtime, closer to graduation. And he's about to enter his senior year, certainly the most stressful of your high school years. He talked about joining the Marines, but they have no record of him applying. Did he feel like he was about to fall off a cliff? Did somebody break up with him? What happened that made this seem like the right thing to do in his head? We don't know yet, but we'll find out.
Thank you both. And more on this breaking story, the Texas Attorney General now, Ken Paxton, joins me on the phone. And Attorney General, I appreciate your time. A terrible day for Texas and for this country. I know you have been briefed just moments ago. Obviously, we have seen the suspect now appear in court. What can you tell us from your latest briefing, Attorney General?
Well, there's not a whole lot new. A lot of what you've been talking about, sort of really no warning signs. We're still trying to figure out if that we've missed something on that front that would have given us clues ahead of time. Obviously, you know, we're looking at another person and just continuing to do our investigation.
And when you say looking at another person, is it fair to say you believe this person was involved, helping, witting, or are you unsure at this time?
At this point, I wouldn't want to comment on that. I think you'll be hearing things very shortly.
All right. So that means that there is something to know that we will know very shortly.
Well,
are you attorney?
I'm actually saying no comment on that. I'm not saying either way.
Okay. Are you looking for others?
Definitely pursuing all options. Law enforcement from both the federal, state, and local are looking at every possible angle, everything related to his background, his friends, all of that's going to be looked at to see if anybody participated in helping him do this. Because obviously, if they're out there, you know, we want to know.
Do you, at this point, do law enforcement know how many explosive devices there were, of the IEDs, the pipe bombs, the pressure cooker bomb? Do you know, or are they still at this point looking to see if they have found them all?
They're still investigating. They're still looking to make sure that they have found them all. So yeah, the answer is no. We don't know everything yet.
And to this point about no red flags, what makes you all so confident that there weren't any?
Well, I mean, it's just confident about what we know now. I mean, this is obviously an investigation that just started today, so it's not going to be over anytime soon. It may be that they're, after pursuing this, with as many resources as we've got behind this, with so many law enforcement people involved, we may find red flags. But at this point, we don't have any, which is obviously unusual. So it may be at some point we do find something, because that's just not the typical. They are typically warning signs when somebody goes off and does something this horrific.
And at this point, do you have any sense as to motive?
Not any, but I will say this. What's nicer about this case as far as finding motive is we actually have a live suspect.
Yes.
And so many of these cases, these people are, you know, they don't end up coming out alive. And so you end up, you know, wondering about that for the rest of your life. So.
Yeah.
That is one good part that we will have the opportunity to try to figure that out as we go along.
Attorney General Paxton, I appreciate your time. Thank you, sir.
Well, keep us in your prayers. Thank you.
And we will do that. There are 10 people who were killed today, 9 of them students, 1 of them a teacher. 8 of the injured students who you know, now some of them have been released, others are fighting for their life, were sent to Clear Lake Regional Medical Center. It is in Webster, Texas. Dr. Safi Madain leads the emergency room team that treated those patients and those students. Dr. Madain, thank you for your time. So sorry about what you have gone through today, what your team has gone through today. But I know that you've been saving lives. What can you tell us about the patients who are still in your hospital tonight?
I can tell you that out of the 8 patients that came in, 6 were sent home, and the 2 that are here, 1 remains in critical condition, and 1 of them still in fair condition, but they have improved.
They have improved.
Well, thank God for that. Can you tell us what sorts of wounds they had? Obviously, we understand that these would have come from gunshots, but is that consistent with what you saw?
Yes, ma'am. That is exactly what we saw today.
Dr. Medane, our affiliate, KTRK, obviously, where you are in Texas, spoke with a survivor who had been shot in the head but survived. And the bullet actually came out just behind his ear. We have a video here of behind this child's head. Did you see injuries like this? I mean, obviously, it's amazing and incredible that this child seems to be okay and is released but was shot in the head.
Yeah, you know, some injuries, people do okay, right? The bullet goes in, hits soft tissue, comes out the other end without hitting any of the vital organs, doesn't hit any of the vasculature, and so they do really well. Unfortunately, not everybody is in that situation. Some people, these bullets do hit vital organs, and so they're a different situation, and that's the two patients that we have here are examples of that.
And Dr. Medane, I know you said one of them is in fair condition, one in critical. You said they both improved. What happened this morning, though? I mean, you know, you all are there. You're always ready for anything. But this is something, of course, that although it has happened elsewhere, something no one ever expects to happen. What happened when you first heard that there had been a mass shooting?
So as a level two trauma center, we can provide just as high level care as level ones. And so we've been practicing for this. We've been preparing for this type of incident, this mass casualty. We go through drills. And essentially today, we were able to initiate all of the processes that we've been practicing and talking about for the last several years. And so as soon as we heard that a mass casualty was coming in, we just took action. All the resources came down to the ER. Our trauma surgeons came down to the ER, nurses, techs, lab, and we were there to receive the patients.
And of course, you saved so many lives. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us. And our prayers are with the two that you still have and that their condition continues to improve and that they will go home. Dr. Medane, thank you.
Thank you.
And next, President Trump claiming an FBI informant was planted in his campaign. He's called it a bigger scandal than Watergate. But what are the facts? We have new details tonight. New tonight, President Trump says there was a spy in his campaign during the 2016 election. Trump quoting Fox News personalities today on Twitter, writing, "Apparently the DOJ put a spy in the Trump campaign. This has never been done before and by any means necessary. They are out to frame Donald Trump for crimes he didn't commit. Really bad stuff," adds the president. Trump then wrote, "Reports are there was indeed at least one FBI representative implanted for political purposes into my campaign for president," he adds, "if true, all-time biggest political scandal." This comes as Trump's lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, admits Trump is promoting this theory, even though they have absolutely no idea if it's true.
Here's the issue that I really feel strongly about with this informant, if there is one. First of all, I don't know for sure, nor does the president, if there really was one. We're told that.
Told that by whom?
We're told that by people who, for a long time, we've been told that there was some kind of infiltration.
Very clear that he doesn't know. Evan Perez is out front. And Evan, you know, this is a huge charge being ledged, right? Informant, spy. I mean, what do you know about this informant?
Well, that's right. I mean, it's very irresponsible to be using those words, and especially because you know it's driving the president perhaps to a place where he might actually do something about it, Aaron. And the problem is that here's what we know about what this person was doing. This was a person who was a confidential source for the FBI, provided information to the FBI and to the intelligence community in the past, and he interacted with some people who were associated with the Trump campaign. This person was not implanted, as the president said, in the campaign. This person wasn't sent as an undercover spy to infiltrate the campaign. None of those words, I think, would describe this situation. This person simply came forward and provided information to the FBI that was relevant. And keep in mind, all of this happened well before Robert Mueller, the special counsel, is appointed. This is when the FBI was looking into what the Russians were up to with regard to the 2016 election. So all of this is really what the FBI is supposed to do, which is if they see a foreign power trying to interfere with the election, they're supposed to investigate it. And if someone comes in and provides information, they're supposed to accept that and see it and see what matches up. And we're told that some of the information, the source came forward forward with matched other information that the FBI and the intelligence community was getting, Aaron.
All right. Obviously, hugely significant what you're saying, right? Because what you're saying, Evan, is somebody was there or had interactions with the campaign, whatever it might have been, who had been a longtime source, heard or saw something, and then contacted the FBI. So what you're saying is there was no zero placement, right, or implanting.
Right.
This person just happened to be there and then reached out, right?
Right.
That's to make sure.
The adage of see something, say something, that's what happened.
All right, which obviously puts a very, very different light on this than that which the president is putting out there.
Right.
All right, Evan, thank you very much. And I want to go now to former DOJ official Francie Hake and former FBI supervisory special agent and former special assistant to then FBI Director James Comey, Josh Campbell. Josh, you heard Evan's reporting, and you heard what the president has been tweeting out there. The speculation that he's putting out there, obviously, with the clear implication that it's true and he believes it. Spy?
Yeah, well, it all depends on whose side of the investigation one happens to find themselves. If you are the subject of the investigation, you're going to do everything you can to try to discredit those who are doing the investigation. If you're on the side of law enforcement, then you see a person like this for what they are.
Except for this is the president who oversees the FBI, the CIA. This is his law enforcement.
Well, it is in a sense, and I think, you know, I saw him tweeting, I think it was yesterday or the day before, about Obama's FBI, which, you know, I think that when you get into using the possessive form about a law enforcement agency, I don't think that you know, paints a picture that he wants it to. I think, you know, if you look at his tweets, he said that this was really bad stuff, an all-time biggest scandal. I think he's right, but not in the way that he thinks. And, you know, the reason I say that is because I know as a former FBI agent, in order to use an investigative tool as invasive as a confidential human informant, you have to meet a certain set of standards, and you have to get the highest level of approval, you know, within the Justice Department, particularly if you're involving, you know, a presidential candidate. So the fact that the FBI agents were able to meet those hurdles, to overcome those challenges and use this informant, tells me that they were on to a criminal investigation, the results of which the campaign may not like.
Francie, you have more concern.
I do. I disagree completely with Josh. He says that they had enough for a criminal investigation, but that's not what they were doing. This wasn't a criminal investigation. This was a counterintelligence matter, and the standards are massively different. You're talking about invading Americans' privacy using tools that are originally designed to collect foreign intelligence from foreign sources. The standards are different. Everything is different. And here, they treated it like a routine criminal matter, but then they applied for a FISA application. Well, that's what it looks like. They only applied for a FISA application. We don't see any criminal search warrants that were taken by a federal district judge. It's all about the FISA application and those. And one more thing really quickly. Everyone's talking about this potential source inside the Trump campaign. What I don't hear anybody talking about is that oftentimes law enforcement agencies refer to surveillance as a source. I don't know if that's the case here. But what no one's talking about is they could very well have
Our sources are saying it was a U.S. citizen, so it would imply it's a person. I understand your point. I'm not saying we're 100% sure, but I am saying our sources do imply that it was a U.S. citizen. So it would be.
Can I clarify something
Go
real
ahead,
fast
Josh.
Here?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, let me just say that, I mean, you're right in one sense in that national security investigations aren't exactly like criminal investigations. But when you look at investigative tools, the domestic intelligence operation guidelines and the attorney general guidelines that you know very much about from your time there all set the standard for the investigative tool that you can use. And those are the same when it comes to the use of an informant, someone who's been signed up as a confidential human source. So, again, if that was used, if people were coming and, you know, presenting information that they allege was criminal, that could be violating criminal statutes that have to do with counterintelligence investigations. I think it shades things to try to look at it, you know, too much of two different things.
There is the question then of getting